resides where men believe it resides.
I will hurt you for this. A day will come when you think you're safe and happy, and your joy will turn to ashes in your mouth.
It's about power.
This world has gotten very dangerous.
No one is safe.
Killing you would send your brother a message.
Running!
It's massive.
We will take back what was stolen from me.
It takes you by surprise.
You win or you die.
It's war.
I think from the first time Dan and I read George Martin's books, we knew he had taken fantasy to a different place than it had been before, and to a more realistic place. The characters don't feel like they're locked in the eternal struggle of good and evil. They feel like real people who happen to live in a world that's not our world, a world where magic still exists.
Is a much more adult, grounded, and psychologically complex. Probably has more in common with many other HBO shows like The Sopranos and Deadwood.
I think it's more reality-based than fantasy, personally.
And maybe I'm a little bit biased because I sometimes see people of my size, how they are represented in fantasies. They're comical, and I feel like there's some sort of code book that you have to follow in fantasy. With our show, that line is very unclear.
It would be good to have you on the field. The competition has become a bit stale.
I don't fight in tournaments, because when I fight a man for real, I don't want him to know what I can do.
My character is a Lannister, and the Lannister family is the most powerful, the strongest family in all the kingdoms.
They come from amazing privilege. It's sort of messed them up a little bit in terms of how they should be treated.
Starks are enemies.
Everyone who isn't us is an enemy.
The Starks are one of the oldest families in Westeros, and they have a very strong code. They take a lot of pride in being Northerners. South is the place you'd really rather live. It's Southern California as opposed to Alaska. And for the Starks, their motto is winter is coming. Metaphorical in the sense that things are always going to get worse.
The guardsmen just rode in from the hills. They've captured a deserter from the Night's Watch.
They've maintained power in the North for thousands of years, and they really have the respect of the people they lead. And part of that means if someone needs to be executed, for instance, you don't have an executioner do it, you do it yourself, because that's the Stark way.
Don't look away. You did well.
John is not exactly a Stark. He's a Snow. He's got a bastard name. But he is of the North, and his father's Ned Stark, so he's half a Stark.
Bastards get names derived on where they're from. So if you're a northern bastard, you're a Snow. If you're born in the Riverlands and you're a bastard, you're a Rivers, and so forth and so on.
On one side, you have the nurturing maternal family that you see in a lot of the family's characters, but at the same time, the politics of being royal as well. That's kind of really, really fascinating.
Soon you will cross the narrow sea and take back your father's throne. The people drink secret toast to your health. They cry out for their true king.
She's an exiled princess on the run because her father was usurped from the throne. She is with her older brother, Viserys, and he's fiercely ambitious, and he's been planning his return to be king.
Vengeance is obviously another driving motivation.
This is a ruthless world. This is a world where people are constantly killing each other, and often they do so to avenge a prior crime. And of course, the cycle of vengeance is you kill somebody, that just means that now you're the target for the next person in the vengeance cycle. So vengeance drives a number of the different narrative threads.
In my dreams, I kill him every night.
Robert Baratheon came to power as a warrior. This is someone who won the throne through violence. Any attempted rebellions would be dealt with a show of real force.
He has two brothers. One is Renly Baratheon, who's the younger brother. He's never fought in anything. His other brother, Stannis, on the other hand, Stannis is a proven commander. The problem with Stannis is nobody likes him.
Stannis is your older brother. We all know what Stannis is.
He inspires no love or loyalty.
Very well-written characters. That's the core of the show.
Everybody can relate to someone.
Who but you can protect the king? It
covers all bases, and I think that's why people get so passionate about it, that they can lose themselves in these characters and in their stories.
Some people hold a grudge, some people don't.
I'll try to keep you alive for her sake.
The tension is always so high. And then you can decipher for yourself as an audience member who you believe should have the power.
first book was written 20 years ago, and there's still so much that seems to apply to what's going on today. When you're writing about people striving for power, that's so much of what drives the world.
When you play the Game of Thrones, you win or you die.
It's been interesting working on the first season and seeing the response to it and seeing people try to apply things that they saw on Game of Thrones to real-world events.
You have the saying, power corrupts, and I think that's very true.
There was a raven from King's Landing. Jon Arryn is dead.
The king's most important advisor is called the Hand to the King, and the former Hand has died under mysterious circumstances, so King Robert travels north to ask the most trusted friend to come back to the capital with him and serve as his chief advisor, as his hand.
Lord Eddard Stark, I would name you the Hand of the King.
One of the primary conflicts in the show is when Ned is called south and given no choice to help out his best and oldest friend in the world.
They were raised together. They learned how to fight together. Robert just looks on Ned as a true brother. I mean, Robert has two brothers that he doesn't like or trust, but there was no one else out there that Robert could give that much faith and confidence in. It had to be Ned Stark.
We were meant to rule together.
Ned doesn't want to do it. He hates politics, doesn't want any part of that. He's a guy who's spent most of his life fighting in wars and now really just wants to spend the rest of his life with his family in relative quiet.
I belong here with you, not down south in that rat's nest they call a capital.
His wife reminds him the last hand might have been murdered, and he's putting himself into a very dangerous situation. He ends up going south with his two daughters, and nothing is ever the same after that.
Ned is a very good man. He's the one we're rooting for. And that's because he is noble. He believes in doing the right thing.
There's great honor serving in the Night's Watch. The Starks have manned the wall for thousands of years. He might not have my name, he had my blood.
The Night's Watch is a band of men who have been guarding the South from what lies beyond the wall for millennia. And what lies beyond the wall in this day and age is thought to be wildlings and probably not a huge threat, but we know there to be other things that may be rising.
I'm ready to swear your oath.
You don't understand why you'd be giving up.
The vow for the Night's Watch is you forsake having children, you forsake having a wife, you forsake anything that was from your old life, you give your life to protecting the realms.
Welcome.
Tyrion says to Jon that he's an outsider as well. They're both outsiders, and you have to arm yourself with what you're called, be it bastard or dwarf or little man, and then can never be used to hurt you.
Why do you read so much?
My brother has a sword, and I have my mind, and a mind needs books like a sword needs a whetstone.
Tyrion is someone who's always had an affinity for other outcasts. He grew up a dwarf in a society where if you were born a peasant and you were a dwarf, your father would have carried you out into the wilderness and left you there for the wolves. Luckily, he was born into a very wealthy family.
It's about family and what family means and how loyalties and how love for those around you can make them do things which they wouldn't necessarily do otherwise.
You're not thinking of taking the black. And go celibate.
Cersei just wants him dead, and she loathes Tyrion.
We can get under each other's skins very easily, because we sort of know each other's secrets and know each other's desires and know how to exploit it to our advantage.
And he's not afraid of his sister. Almost everyone in the kingdoms is afraid of Cersei, but Tyrion's not, and he's known about the affair with Jaime for a very long time.
Well, he fell in love with the wrong woman in so many ways. In this case, he fell in love with his sister.
Targaryens wed brothers and sisters for 300 years to keep bloodlines pure.
Dany has only known what her brothers told her. She is incredibly submissive, and she is completely dominated by her older brother.
She's a princess, but she's also her brother's pawn in being sold into marriage to someone she perceives as a terrifying barbarian from an alien culture.
Do you see how long his hair is? When Dothraki are defeated in combat, they cut off their braid so the whole world can see their shame. Khal Drogo has never been defeated.
She's being married off to Khal Drogo, a horse lord of the Dothraki. And this marriage is purely for Viserys' political convenience. He wants to go back home and conquer Westeros. The problem is he doesn't have an army. And so the easiest way for him to get an army is to get one by marrying off his sister to a Dothraki horse lord who has a horde of 40,000 tough fighters. And so the deal that Viserys thinks he strikes is, you get to marry my sister, and then you'll come with me and we'll fight my enemies and conquer Westeros.
Their wedding day is not how you'd hope your wedding day would go.
A Dothraki wedding without at least three deaths is considered a dull affair.
He's an incredibly aggressive warrior who doesn't speak her language. So first and foremost, there's a language barrier there.
This is her new society, and she's initially repelled by them. But as she starts to travel with them and ride with them and spend more and more time with them, she actually comes to really admire them and have a great deal of respect for their culture.
It kind of turns from being this horrific, arranged, violent marriage to a beautiful love story, and they're kind of perfect for each other. So it turns into something quite gorgeous.
You're not supposed to be here.
No!
They come into our home and try to murder my brother.
Do you know whose dagger this is?
I do.
Tyrion Lannister, the Imp.
The strongest characters in the story are female, and I like to think of the duel between the two mothers of the competing families, Catelyn Stark and Cersei Lannister.
They seem diametrically opposed in many other ways, but they're both women who were driven to very extreme actions to protect their children.
This man came into my house and there conspired to murder my son. I call upon you to seize him.
The wonderful thing for me is that it's got some strong women in it, which is wonderful as a young girl to be playing such a strong female role.
I've heard the show be referred to as feminist. We have characters such as Cersei the Queen or Daenerys the Exiled Princess who find their strength through being wronged. And they're possibly some of the strongest characters and the most brutal in a lot of ways.
The next time you raise a hand to me will be the last time you have hands.
This is the first time that she starts to take matters into her own hands and she starts to kind of see who she could become. She sees something in Khal Drogo that gives her the courage to make the best of this situation.
A Targaryen at the head of a Dothraki army.
The narrow sea still lies between us.
Ned is a very straightforward person and finds himself dealing with backstabbers and double dealers. No matter how effective he is at being Ned Stark, he's really not very well equipped to handle them.
We've come to a dangerous place. We must protect ourselves, look after one another.
Ultimately, those qualities that we consider positive qualities become liabilities for him.
I'm looking for my brother.
You kill me, your brother's a dead man.
He loves Tyrion, and I think it's mutual. Is that both Lannisters, and they like to play with people's ideas of them.
Have you ever heard the phrase, rich as a Lannister? Of course you have. You're a smart man.
I was falsely accused of attempted murder.
They kept me at the Eyrie in a sky cell, and the fourth wall of the cell is basically a cliff.
The show is often about the misuse and abuse of power and what happens when people end up with power that they're not really fit to wield and what can go wrong.
Bend the knee and swear loyalty to my son.
Robert Baratheon dies and his young, unfit son sits on the throne.
Bring me his head.
You hear this kind of whispers as you start to make the show. Are you really going to kill your lead in the first season? And we were nervous about that scene and also couldn't have been more excited because it's really the emotional climax of the season.
Ned's death becomes the occasion for a struggle to return freedom to the North. That's only the tip of the iceberg.
John has a huge dilemma. He finds out what is going on south of the Wall and that his brother's riding to war.
You took the oath, you can't leave.
He didn't expect his family to be wronged in such a way. I think it takes huge courage for him to forsake them, really, and to stick with what his task is. It's a big decision, and it creates who he is going into season two.
the world became a much more dangerous place. You know, open war started to break out between Rob and the South. They're all in danger always.
The world has gotten darker, it's gotten more violent. None of our characters are in safe places anymore.
It certainly makes actors read their scripts quicker, knowing that anyone could die at any point.
So it just keeps you guessing and it keeps you on your toes. You never know which family you're going to be rooting for.
There's such a wide variety of fans out there. It doesn't just appeal, I don't think, to one demographic.
What I always wanted is for the show to not disappoint them. And Danny is such a character that people either love or they hate, but it's always been positive. Luckily, I've had no one say, you're rubbish, which is always good. Everyone's just been wonderful. The final image seems to be the one that people kind of speak about most.
People go, yeah, I saw it, and I had to go and buy all the books. And I mean, I go, wow, that's cool. That's amazing.
I remember having a conversation with an HBO executive and saying, you know, this isn't the kind of show that gets nominated for things because they don't like fantasy shows, science fiction. This just doesn't happen. Dan, my partner, said we just got nominated for an Emmy, and it was pretty surreal. And it was great to see Peter get nominated and so many of the people who had worked so hard on the show.
I remember exactly when they called out Peter's name. I was definitely shouting out. I was just so happy for him. I was so happy for the show. The Golden Globes is a little slightly different event because there's wine and champagne on the table. But when he won, that was also just an amazing experience for everybody.
Any recognition is really great. You pretend to be cynical about it, but it's great. When something that you love and really respect and love being a part of turns into a hit or popular, it's a really great feeling.
To have that recognized so early on, it's glorious. It's incredible.
The world just got a lot bigger. By season two, we're already at war, so there's no more peace. Basically, everywhere you go, this world has gotten very, very dangerous. There are more characters, and things just got a lot more brutal.
We do have a clash of kings, several kings, and we have a lot of people who believe they are the rightful king.
Many of the characters who were together in one another's presence in season one have been dispersed to the four winds in season two. It was definitely bigger in scope and feel.
The locations we were at were so stunning that, they kind of look CGI'd. We went there to not CGI things, and I think that makes the show what it is. Everything's done in a very real way.
The ability to go to places like Malta or Croatia or Iceland to shoot affords us an opportunity to hit a kind of a realistic note that is never possible, no matter how brilliant the sets are.
That affects the actors, too. It puts us there. When you're in a cave up in the mountains and you're there and you can see your own breath and you don't have to CGI breath, you're cold. And you don't have to act cold, so it does a lot of the work for you.
We've been able to do it the way we want to. We've been able to go to all these far-flung locations with an incredible cast. I mean, the books have such a huge ensemble of characters, and so many of those roles are really vital. It's not as if it's a one-man show with a bunch of side characters. There are really 20 characters in the show who all are often the leaders in their particular scenes.
We've got some new characters who are fascinating and wonderful and bring new dimensions and textures and bring out new things in the characters that we already know and love. And again, more brilliant women, more brilliant, strong, feisty, wonderful women who are just going to dominate.
The time to strike is now. The Starks fight the Lannisters, the Baratheons fight each other.
All of our characters are in increasingly dangerous circumstances, and even the characters that you might think of as villains, in their minds, they're actually doing the right thing.
It's not all black and white with Jamie. It's got the twists and surprises.
Do you think that you can't beat dragons? But actually, the reality of that is that they're stuck in a wasteland, and whilst having dragons is kind of the biggest miracle that this world has seen, it's not going to put a roof over their heads or food on the table. And so that's kind of the first struggle that you see her deal with.
What you can expect from this season is more bloodshed. There's more epic sword fighting. It doesn't hold back any punches.
You're going to be left on a knife edge again and again.
Not to give too much away, but fans who want blood and battle won't be disappointed with season two.
The cold winds are rising.
The War of Five Kings, they're calling it. Nothing matters but how it ends.
Heard some of the men talking about the comet.
Red comet means one thing, boy.
dragons.
Power is a curious thing. It's a trick, a shadow on the wall.
This is what ruling is. Lying on a bed of weeds, ripping them out before they strangle you in your sleep.
The king is a lost cause. It's the rest of us I'm worried about now.
You have inherited your father's responsibilities. They come at a cost.
I love her.
I saw it.
Whatever it was, you'll see it again.
When my dragons are grown, we will burn cities to the ground.